From family events, to volunteer opportunities, to community happenings, there is a lot going on in your community. Learn about all the possibilities and opportunities on this episode of Community Hotline.
Hi, I'm Curtis Satino, and I'm in for Monica Weitzel today for Community Hotline. Our first guests this afternoon are Huey Ong and Fipe Havea from APANO, the Asian Pacific American Network of Oregon. Welcome to the show. Thanks for coming, you guys.
Thank you, Curtis.
Why don't we start off with you telling us a little bit about the organization, a little background.
APANO, the Asian Pacific American Network of Oregon, was first established back in the 90s. It was API elders within the community, and so...
Can you explain API?
API is an acronym for Asian Pacific Islanders, okay. And so I'll be referring to that throughout the time.
Okay, just want to make
sure.
Yeah. There's so much lingo.
Right. And so it was established back in the 90s, Asian Pacific Islander elders, and so due to lack of activity and involvement, it just kind of phased out. And then back in 2008, that's when APANO revived again, and it has... recently, back in 2011, received its 501c3 status as a nonprofit organization, and so we've just recently, a little over two years, as a nonprofit organization.
And what does that status gain you exactly?
I think one of the great things about APANO, kind of the opportunities and kind of why the need for this coalition to kind of grow is, you know, as Asian Pacific Islanders were actually one of the fastest growing populations in Oregon. And you know, we saw that there was a need for our voices to be heard. And so APANO is a statewide organization to really engage a multi-ethnic as well as a multi-generational community in, you know, the electoral process, in the political process, and really to amplify our voices together. Because I think, you know, when you talk about Asian Americans, there's actually a pretty broad, multilingual, multi-ethnic community. So how do we see some of our self-interest in, you know, building out a coalition together? But then also, like, what are some of the differences and some of the challenges in, you know, how do we develop, you know, leaders and grassroots, you know, voices in, you know, our decision and political processes?
Okay. So speaking of politics, then back in the fall, you guys did something unique. You had a multilingual phone bank. You want to talk about that a little bit? That sounds kind of cool.
Yeah. So we've held, like what you said, a unique multilingual phone bank, and we've had over 100 volunteers volunteering over 100 shifts, of course, and we've had over 10 languages spoken at each shift. And to support our volunteers, we even translated voter guides in over seven different languages. We've also, part of our Get Out the Vote campaign, we've also distributed those voter guides to different API small local businesses. And so we've reached how many voters?
I actually don't know the numbers, but...
You can make up a number.
It's totally fine. But I think... our electoral work and our get out the vote work, I think everyone is doing something in a presidential election, but I think one of our uniqueness was our multilingual phone banks where people were reached out to in their native language, which I think is very rare for some of these communities to actually hear their native language spoken about politics. So, you know, we thought it was very important to engage and do that level of outreach. But that's, you know, for us to build up, you know, our communication and our contacts to these different communities. We actually even got an opportunity to do voter registration at the swearing-in ceremonies for new citizens, which is very exciting for us to, you know, be there when folks are, you know, getting their citizenship and registering them and, you know, getting them involved later on.
Is 10 languages enough to cover?
Not even close to the amount of languages that are out there, for sure. Yeah. And, you know, the populations and the communities that are growing in Oregon are, you know, I think lots of communities that people might not even have heard of. And, you know, there's Bhutanese growing population, Nepalese. You know, so those are like other ethnic communities that I think oftentimes goes beyond just the kind of mainstream Chinese, Vietnamese, Japanese kind of three-prong mm-hmm. API images. Mm-hmm. So it's really good to provide that space for these smaller communities to come out and have an amplified voice.
Okay, so it's kind of a start then, and perhaps these people who weren't able to be heard or connect before, mm-hmm. you were able to reach them for the election, getting out the vote with that intent. And so now coming into 2013, you've made connections with these people in the fall, and you're going to roll that into some further activities. What's going on then?
Yeah.
So we've hosted numbers of policy forums, and so so we've had a couple back in November, December, and just recently, this past Saturday, we've held a policy forum in Salem, and our upcoming policy forum will be held the 31st of this month in Eugene. So that's targeting the Lane County community. And so so with these policy forums, it's basically to open up a space and provide an opportunity for the API communities to come together and discuss policy issues that affect our communities directly, whether it's tuition equity or if it's earned sick days or the driver's license restoration policy. And so
earned sick days, how would that be different? How is that an issue?
Maybe I could maybe step back just a little step and talk about the fact that, you know, we did all this electoral work and mm-hmm. engage people in the voter process, but also a lot of our communities aren't able to actually be registered voters, but their voices are still needed to be heard because they're Oregonians, they're part of this community. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's lots of different issues people could take on, and, you know, we know that there's lots of different things in the API community could take on. We decided, you know, for 2013 to really focus on two main areas. One, around health equity, really looking at the health disparities that are out there that impacts our communities, and, you know, really think about very specific ways to, you know, address change. So I think the paid sick days is one of those, you know, places where how do we think about economic justice as well as, you know, thinking of the API voice in that particular strategy. A lot of them are, you know, small business owners, and how would they be impacted, but also the benefits of, you know, not having folks go to work sick and you know, engage their customers and getting them sick. You know, it's actually a pretty mm-hmm. important issue. And kind of the other main, you know, kind of focus for us is educational access. Mm-hmm. For a lot of English language learners, ELL we call these communities, there's actually been a lot of disparities in our school systems, and how do we actually amplify the voice of parents and API parents in particular in these spaces so that, you know, the funding actually matches the programs. And, you know, oftentimes when it's, you know, tough budget situations, our communities are often the ones first on the chopping blocks because they don't have that political voice, right? Okay. So a big part of APANO's reason to engage in these areas of work is because it directly impacts both our families, our children, and their educational access, as well as the help that they're able to receive.
Okay, great. And so the forums then are an opportunity to basically get to the details of some of the stuff that you're interested in or trying to affect.
Yeah, absolutely. I think one of the cool things about the forums is it provides a space where we're not just telling people what the issues are out there. It's actually an opportunity to engage with communities around their own personal histories, right? You know, we're not paid lobbyists as an organization. All of us are mm-hmm. mostly volunteers. We have a small staff, but that helps us coordinate. But, you know, it provides a space for our own expertise to come out, right? Because we are directly affected by the issues, and being mm-hmm. able to hear those stories are pretty important for us. So the forum provides that space, but then it's not just a place to vent, right? We actually do want people to take steps and action. So we want to engage in the political process, both locally in our different city councils, but then also on a statewide level at the Capitol. So that you know, our forums leads into that level of work.
And is this primarily a Portland? What's your community, I guess?
Yeah. I mean, there's a huge concentration of APIs in general. So in the metro area, so for sure we have a bigger population of activists and members here. Mm-hmm. But we have expanded and grown. We actually do want to have a statewide focus. And there's actually pockets of communities in Eugene and into Ashland and even into the Salem area. So it's nice to be able to do that level of outreach. And we actually try to identify regionally how we put these forums together, so there actually will be a forum in Eugene, you know, central for some other folks to be able to participate.
But so far the forums have just been right here in Portland?
No, we've had other ones, and we've done our electoral work also, you know, statewide, out of Eugene as well as in Salem, as well as in Portland and kind of this area.
Beaverton.
Metro area. Beaverton.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else you want to say about the policy forums that are coming up?
No.
That's,
okay. Yeah. So exciting opportunity for folks to get involved.
So how would somebody find out about attending or participating in one of the forums?
So folks can visit our website at www.apano.org, and we'll have information of location, time, and whatnot about our upcoming last policy forum, which will be the 31st of this month in Eugene. And I know for Portlanders who would want to attend is a bit of a commute, but those who are in the Eugene area would are more than welcome to attend. And
one that's actually coming up even a little bit sooner is on February 16th in the Portland Community College Southeast Branch. We will have our State of Cultural Competency Forum, where we're going to talk a little bit about particularly the health equity issues. And, you know, it's a pretty sizable group of folks that come together and, you know, listen to kind of where we're at on the issue, but then also ways to be involved moving forward in 2013.
Is that the 82nd and Foster?
Yeah. It's
okay. Yes.
It's a great space. So.
Yeah. It's nice that they converted that into something useful there. You want to talk a little bit about the legislative agenda that you have?
Yeah, I think what we want to do is actually build out a grassroots base of folks being able to be engaged in the political process. So to actually be in Salem, to be in the city council. And as we know, like, there's tons of bills that will come through. So we work in coalition with a lot of different organizations to both track good bills and actually weigh in on good bills, but then also to think about the impact of some bad bills that people might not know about and engage our members around. Some of the key legislative issues are we really want to move forward a uniform data collection standard for race, ethnicity, and the language. We actually have a bill in the state legislature, and we'll be moving that.
What does that mean exactly?
It's pretty important for us to, in terms of servicing our different communities, right? We're pretty diverse. As an API community, and if we are able to understand our data and how do we collect data in terms of ethnic backgrounds, it helps us sharpen how we provide services as a state. This is very important in the health area, in health services, but also in areas of education, knowing just the demographics of the communities we want to be serving.
So getting a clearer picture of
absolutely. Okay. I just think it's a smart move, right, for our state to be involved in. There's other issues. We definitely want to work to the fluoridation of Portland's water system, and it's pretty important for the API communities. There's definitely data out there that connects oral health with fluoridization, and particularly for low-income and people of color communities. So we definitely want to see that through, particularly for the Portland metro area. There's a lot of other different bills. I won't get into it, but there's opportunities for folks to learn about the different issues. We also are talking about looking at the budget and making sure that the programs that are supporting the English language learners in our schools aren't on the chopping block, and there's transparency behind the budget process around what's being weighed against other programs. We work in coalition because we feel it's important that we have a united voice, not just within the API community, but also other communities that oftentimes are on the chopping block as well, because our budgets are tight for sure. And being able to have an opportunity to weigh in and have people really rethink their priorities in Salem is important for our families and our communities to speak up.
Just to be visible.
Absolutely.
And just to back that up, we also have a Ledge Day coming up. And so for folks
What day?
A legislative day. Okay. Sorry, so it's a legislative day coming up. April 17th, so it's actually the day after the State of Cultural Competency Forum, and that'll be at 8 a.m. where folks, volunteers, and those who are interested in attending with APANO will head down to Salem and do all the work that Hui had just explained.
Okay. So. Are you going to be driving everybody?
We're going to get a bus. Access to Salem is not easy oftentimes. Some of our folks are local commuters, some actually don't drive, both elders and youth that we want to engage in this process. And it's kind of nice. We actually have our APANO shirts, and we kind of take over the Capitol. It's really nice to engage our elected officials who actually appreciate the voices that we bring to the table. Because oftentimes, they kind of see the same lobbyists a lot, and we provide a different, hopefully, voice to their space and share different stories and the impact that their decisions have on our communities it's important to hear from their constituencies.
Great. And what does someone have to do to get a t-shirt?
Well, you can definitely work through the website and actually order one, I think, through our website.
Yeah, sure. Just as long as you volunteer.
We'll get you one, Curtis,
for sure. Okay. Yeah, I do need one because I look great in red.
Great in red. I imagine so, for sure.
Well, is there anything else you guys want to talk about? We just have a couple seconds left, but I feel like we've hit all the points and have a good, clear picture of what you guys are hoping to do.
And we're really excited for the opportunity to continue to work with this television program. It's great to have access here.
Awesome. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah.
Well, thanks for coming in, you guys. Please stay tuned for our next guests, and we'll be going to a break just about now. Thanks so much.
Real cool, Curtis. That was fun.
Oh, good job, you guys. Yeah.